Welcome to the New Generation Church Podcast. We're so glad you're here. Whether you're a regular or a first-time listener, we hope today's message fills you with hope and inspiration. NGC is a place where people can come together to grow in their faith, learn from one another, and support each other through life's challenges by living out the Word of God.
And we're going to continue share the love of
Jesus in everything we do, and we're excited to bring that love to you through our podcast. Let's dive into today's message.
One God, one body, one house. One of the animals that was created when God said, gave Adam the ability to name animals, was an animal called the Belgium horse. Now, here's something interesting about the Belgium horse, and I'm talking about unity right now, because a Belgium horse, they're huge. They weigh thousands of pounds, and one horse by himself can pull 8,000 pounds, just one horse. One horse can pull 8,000 pounds. Here's the amazing thing, and what I want to bring with you about unity. You can take another Belgium horse who has never connected with the horse that I just talked about, and you can put them together, and together, I know what you're thinking. You're saying, Pastor, you're going to say 16,000 pounds. No, they can pull together, they can pull 24,000 pounds. Now, what I share that example with you is, I'm not talking necessarily about the horses, but what I want to talk about is the power of unity. When we come together as one, synergy is created and great things can happen in God's kingdom. Somebody give God a praise for unity right now in the name of Jesus. Unity is God's idea. In fact, in the book of Genesis, you remember, and we're going to get into our message here in a minute, but in Genesis chapter 11, the Bible says of the people that they came together and they began to build a tower to God. And it goes on to say that there was nothing that could separate them from accomplishing building that tower because they had the same language and they did everything the same. Well, God had to come down. He said, let us go down. And he came and he confused their language. And that's why we have various languages today, even, because God came down and he had to confuse their language because they were building something, but they were building it not unto God. They were building it unto themselves. So you got to be careful that when we build things, we got to make sure that we're building on the right foundation. We got to make sure that God is getting the glory in that. And there's no better way to build other than building in community. So we're talking about community, and we have been for the last couple of weeks, but there's unity in community. Now, today I want to introduce you to a community in the book of Philippi. On last week, we talked about Paul when he went to Athens in Acts chapter 17. You can go back and read that. And then he came across an idol that they set aside to an unknown god. And Paul had to come and let them know about the god that they were missing. In fact, that was the God that trumped all other gods that were in place. They need to know about the unknown God. And Paul revealed that to them, that this God that you're talking about is the God of all gods. Does somebody know the God of all gods today? Talking about the God, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And this happened in a community of people who did not know God. How many of y'all know that we're in a community of people who do not know God? And we need to let them know about the goodness and the love and the grace of our God. Well, if you back up to Acts 16, we find what we call a Christian community. All right, a Christian community. Let me give you a definition of Christian community. Not going to be before you long, but I want you to understand the importance of community today. A Christian community on your screens as well. Watch this now on your screens. It's a Christian community is comprised of people of various ages, ethnic, and economic groups who love Jesus, fellowship together, and serve together. Can I read that again one more time? All right. A Christian community, when you think about a Christian community, I want you to think about people composed of various ages, ethnic, and economic groups who love Jesus, fellowship together, and serve one another. So as you look around, even in this community, we see that represented. We have people of various ages. We have people of various economical and social statuses. But the one thing we have in common, or we're striving to have in common, is that we all love Jesus. Not only we all love Jesus, but we all love to fellowship together, and we all love to serve together, because when God created the church, this was his idea of the church, a church who could love Jesus and a church who could love others in spite of what was happening. Now, in the passage of scripture today, in the book of Philippians, you don't need to stand, we'll get there quickly, but we're introduced to a people who comprise of a Christian community. Now, they were not always Christians, but they grew into the knowledge and wisdom of who Jesus was. So let me read the scripture, and then we'll get right into it this morning. In the book of Philippians, it says in verse 1, therefore, if there is any encouragement in Christ, if there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, make my joy complete by being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Somebody say one purpose. One purpose. Do nothing from selfish or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interest of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, yeah, even the death on a cross. So in this community, we find the Apostle Paul. Remember, he's in prison, and he's writing this letter to the church at Philippi. Now, you'll find more information, go back and read it, put in your margin, about the church of Philippi in the book of Acts chapter 16. But this was a church, if you will, that was founded by the Apostle Paul. When he came to the church of Philippi, there was a man by the name of Timothy, who was not a Jew, but he took Timothy as his son in the faith, and he began to invite him into the community, and they began to witness and tell others about Jesus Christ. Before that, Paul received a vision that he is not to go to Asia, but he is to go to Macedonia because there's a man there who needs his help. See, God will direct your paths for the betterment of people in the community who need to know about Jesus. You might have your mind made up to do one thing, but God says, nope, I need to redirect your path so that you can go and let somebody else know about the love of Jesus and everything that he's brought you through in your life. Do I got a witness in this place today? If he's brought us through anything, there are people that you haven't even met yet that need to know that your story is for his glory. And if it wasn't for Jesus, you wouldn't be the person you are today. But because of him, you can give him praise and you can give him adoration for who he is. He will direct your path. He will reorder your steps so that you can come in contact with people in your community that you can begin to share the love of Jesus with. So not only does Paul and Silas and Luke, who is the author of Acts, not only are they forming community, but they come across this woman by the name of Lydia, because Lydia is a seller of purple, meaning that she was a very rich woman. She was a seller of purple, but she began to hear the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, and it moved on her heart so much to the degree that she became not only a rich woman, but watch this, she became a rich saved woman. And that makes the difference, all right? You can be rich all you want, but you need to be rich and saved, right? And she was rich and saved, and that made all the difference in her life, and community is being formed. These men continue to minister, and they come across a woman, a little girl, in fact, who's possessed with the devil. And in fact, the Bible says that she made her masters much profit because she was a fortune teller. And Paul, she became a distraction, in fact, as they were preaching. She walked around behind them, and she kept repeating, these are men of the Most High God. These are men of the Most High God. And that was true, but she didn't need, in other words, God didn't need an advertising campaign to let him know that his men were doing the work of God. So what did they do? They stopped what they were doing. They laid hands on this girl and they cast the demon out of that girl. And then those men could not profit anymore. See, community is being formed. You got a rich woman. You got a formerly possessed demonic woman. But not only that, when Paul and Silas begin to preach, they're now thrown in jail. They're thrown in a place where it looks like it's not going to work out for them. But as they're locked up in those shackles and chains, remember, I always say that they forgot to lock one thing up. They forgot to lock their mouths up. All right. Because what they began to do is they began to sing songs and praises to God. And as they began to sing song and praises to God, the jail began to rock. Oh, I'm telling you today, people of God, I don't care where you are or how low you get. If the devil hasn't blocked your mouth up and he can't do that, what you need to begin to do is give God praise and begin to watch your foundation shake and God come in and intervene so that you can be on display for your community. See, God has you on display for your community. He wants people to know that, man, I ain't always been like this. God has done a work in me. And guess what? He's still doing a work in me. And then men begin to sing songs and praises. And the jailers were all loosed in that place. And there was a jailer that locked them up in the place who was about to commit suicide. He was about to take his own life. But Paul began to show him the light. He began to show him about the love of Jesus. And that jailer that locked them up asked the question, what must I do to be saved? And that man and his whole house in that community was saved because of the opposition that Paul and Silas had to go through. Can you lead somebody to Jesus by virtue of what he's done in your life? Can you point to your life and say, ain't nobody done this but Jesus, and I give him the glory and the praise for it. But notice there's community that's being formed. There's a rich woman, there's a formerly demonic, possessed girl, and then there's this jailer. And all these people are experiencing the power, the authentic power and move of God. The three things as Paul writes this letter to the Philippian church that we're going to talk about today that I want to discuss with you, because he's in jail, but he's still encouraged. And he's writing them a very powerful letter that we're going to talk about in our few minutes remaining today, because I want you to know that there's unity in your community. Say that with me. Somebody say unity and make it personal. Say in my community. I believe God, and I'm crazy enough to believe him, that if you don't have unity, even in your family right now, we're going to come in agreement with the Most High God who created the heavens and the earth, that there will be unity even in your family. Amen. In your church, if there's any isms or schisms or people trying to do things outside of the will of God, we're going to believe today that God, you are the God of unity, and you command blessings where there's unity. And we thank you in advance, Lord God, that you're establishing unity in the family, in the church, not only here, but all throughout the land that we're a part of. We got to start proclaiming what God has said in his word. We're too much in acceptance mode, and we have the attitude as, oh, this is the way it's always going. It ain't always going to be like this. Well, it is what it is. No, it ain't is what it is, right? No, God says there's unity, and he commands blessings in unity. So we're preaching to ourselves. We're preaching to other people because unity starts with you. Amen. You're part of the community today. All right. Watch this beautiful letter that Paul pens to the church at Philippi. The first point, and there are three things I want to give you today. The first thing I want you to know is this. I want you to know, and all these proceed with people in Christian community. Somebody say people in Christian community. I can't hear you. Say people in Christian community. Now watch this. Now, if you're a Christian and you're in community, or you desire to be a Christian and to be in community, watch this now. People in Christian and community, number one, they shine bright in displaying the true unity of the Spirit. They shine bright in displaying the true unity of the Spirit. Notice this now in Philippians chapter 2, verse 1 that we read earlier. Paul is saying, after he gives them the introduction, and this is where Paul, you remember, and we quote this scripture a lot, he says, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. What Paul was saying is, I don't know how this story is going to end. I'm locked up and I don't know whether they're going to let me go or whether I'm going to die. But one thing I want you to know, church, one thing I want you to know, community, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. That's powerful, people. That's powerful when you can be able to say, you know what? I'm better off if I die because I gain Christ. I'm better off if I live because I'm here with you and I can share my struggles and my toils and how the Lord has taught me to overcome. But watch what he says here. He says, therefore, that's what the therefore is. Therefore, if there be any encouragement in Christ, that word if, it should be since. If there or since there is any consolation of love, if there is any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and compassion, he says, make my joy complete, being of the same mind, maintaining the same love, united in spirit, intent on one purpose. Somebody say one purpose. One purpose. Now notice the repetitive use of the word same, and it has to do with harmony and unity in the body, because where there is disunity, the Spirit of God does not engage. Okay? God does not dwell in a place where there is disunity. All right? In fact, the Bible says in the book of 1 Peter chapter 3 that if you're a husband here today and you're not living with your wife in an understanding way, you're not dwelling with her according to knowledge, God says you can pray till the cows come home, but because you don't have unity with your wife, I will not answer your prayers. It's in there. Look at it. So you can pray, Lord, Lord, Lord. Say, nope, you're under covenant. If you're married, you need to get unity with your spouse, and then I'll hear your prayers. I just helped somebody out today in the name of Jesus. Somebody going to go and tell somebody, hey, you need to read 1 Peter chapter 3 because pastor said this might be the reason your prayers are not being answered. You need to tell somebody that today in the name of Jesus. But God will not dwell where there's disunity. All right. Understand that. He will not dwell. Now, on the other hand, or consequently, where there is unity, watch this now, the Spirit of God is right at home. Where there's unity, the Spirit of God is right at home. He will dwell where there is unity because he is unity. He will dwell where there is unity because he is unity. Let me make this practical for you. They just got through with March Madness and basketball season is going on, but a basketball team is unified not because every player plays the same position. That would be uniformity. All right? That's not what we're talking about here. A basketball team is unified because they are operating in harmony to reach the same basket. Each player is playing, watch this, his or her own position with the objective of either helping the team score or stopping the opposing team from scoring. Everyone is moving in the same direction with the same purpose. Somebody say one. Amen. It should be the objective of every church that's open under the name of Jesus that everybody gets the opportunity to know Jesus. You know what gets in the way of that? And I'm going to talk about that in a minute, because one of the reasons Paul is writing this letter is because there's some contention going on in the church of Philippi. There are two women, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. You can read about it. And there's some contention going on between these two women. And Paul says, wait a minute. Now, if there be any encouragement, if Christ has done anything for you, don't allow these little sparks of fire to mess up what God is doing. Okay. Somebody says you need to get out the way. Amen. You need to get out the way. He's saying, you know what? We got to keep the unity. We have to keep the unity. So notice this. Now we shine bright in displaying the true unity of the Spirit. When you have the Spirit of God inside of you, he will shine through you. You don't have to wear, watch this now, and I'm not opposed to this, but you understand what I'm saying. You don't have to wear a t-shirt so that people can think you holy. You don't have to have a bumper sticker. And if you do, I'm not telling you to go out there and remove your bumper sticker, but what I'm telling you that the brightness of the Spirit of God will shine bright in you wherever you go. Whether you're in church, whether you're at home, whether you're on your job, if the Spirit of God resides in you, you will shine bright. Let your light so shine before men so that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Who is it about? It's the Father in heaven. It better be about him. All right. But you don't have to do anything except allow the Spirit of God to work in and through you. Let me further illustrate this point. Go to Ephesians. Watch this now. If you're taking notes, we're talking about unity in community because the Lord Jesus desires unity in his church. What do you mean? A church that's founded by Jesus Christ doesn't have unity? What kind of church is that? Now, hold on a minute. Watch this now. In verse 1 of Ephesians chapter 4, the Bible says, this is the same author, Paul. He says, therefore, notice where he is again, the prisoner of the Lord, implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling which you have been called. Now watch this, verse 2, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. Let me ask you a question. Is it hard being patient with people? Anybody, let me ask it like this. I want some authentic folks in here who are going to be real with me today. Raise your hand if you have some problems being difficult with being patient with some people. If you didn't raise your hand, let me talk to you after church and find out what you're doing. Somebody say, but what about church folk? Them are folks you need the most patience with. We need patience. And part of the Christian community, we have to have patience and we have to have love for one another. Let me finish this now because we need instruction. We need instruction, Lord, on what to do and how to do it. Because and he says, with all humility and gentleness, with patience. Somebody say patience. Showing tolerance for one another in love. Being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The bond of peace. There is one body. How many? One body and one Spirit. How many spirits? One Spirit. We're talking about the church now. Just also, you were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all who is over all and through all and in all. If that don't settle it, I don't know what does. There's one. Somebody say one. There's one. There's one sound. There's one voice. There's the same love. There's the same diligence. There's the same spirit of faith. There's the same faith. It's the same love. It's the same. Somebody say same. Same, because this is what the Lord is trying to get into the world so that the world can see that he is still shining bright amongst all the darkness and chaos. So the first thing I wanted you to know is people in Christian community, they shine bright in displaying the true unity of the Spirit. The second thing, and Paul talks about this, people in Christian community, the second thing I want you to know is that they seek for opportunities to serve rather than for opportunities to be served. Okay? If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, one of the attributes that you have by way of now the Holy Spirit living inside of you is you have a desire or should have a desire to serve others, to put others above yourselves. Man, what would the church look like? What would the church look like at large? I'm not just relegating this to us, but the church of Jesus Christ, if we didn't make it all about us, but we made it about somebody else. What if we were a true church that was serious about God's glory, serious about the gain of others, and then serious about our growth spiritually? Well, the way we grow spiritually, the way you're going to grow is by preferring others over yourself. Watch what he says here. Now I'm back in Philippians chapter 2, beginning in verse 3. He says, do nothing for selfish or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard, there's a one another, one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. When you're, watch this now. This is, and I'm talking to the church. Notice he's writing these letters to the church. These are challenges that are going on inside the church. When you walk into a church and you want all eyes on you, you might be in the wrong place. Because when we walk in, if you want all the eyes to be on the pastor, you might be in the wrong place. If you want all the eyes to be on any other auxiliary or ministry in this church, you're looking, or you might be in the wrong place, because we want our eyes focused on the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. Amen. He is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life, and our focus, direction, and attention has to be on him at all times. The reason there's confusion in the earth, and maybe even in churches, is because Jesus is not the center and the base and boundary of the church. He said, upon this rock, I will build my church. Whose church is it? His church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The gates of hell might be prevailing because we've not made it his church, we made it our church. I'm trying to help somebody out today as we get ready to get active in this community that God has planted us in. You gotta get rid of being making it all about you. You can quote the Bible from Genesis to Revelation, praise the Lord for that, but what are you doing for God's people? How are you serving God's people, the church? You've been called out of darkness into the marvelous light. Now that you're in the light, how are you letting your light shine so that men and women can see the good works that you're doing, but give God the glory for it? Paul is saying here to this Philippian church, he says, you know what, y'all? I don't want you to do nothing from selfish or empty conceit, but with humility. We're going to come back to that in a minute. Of mine, I want you to regard one another as more important than yourselves. Notice what Jesus, now Jesus understood this and he modeled this for us. Go to Mark's Gospel, chapter 10, verse 45. Watch this now. Watch this. For even the Son of God, this is a powerful scripture. You need to underscore this in your Bible if it's not underscored. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to what? To serve and give his life a ransom for many. Jesus came from heaven to earth for the sole purpose of serving and not to be served. Man, that's powerful. That's powerful, Lord. Well, how do I do that? He said, you got to get out the way. He says, you're too much making it all about you. And you gotta take a back seat. Let somebody else have that seat of honor that you thought was reserved for you. You ever been in a place where you sat in a place and you looked up and somebody had to come over and tap you on the shoulder and say, you're sitting in the wrong place? You turn around and you see reserved seats and you say, oh, I thought, no, that wasn't for you. Get up and get in the back. That's where you belong. There's somebody of greater honor in this house than you. It's not about you. All right. I'm trying to get you out the way so that we can get Jesus magnified in this place today. Another scripture I want to bring your attention to, because we're talking about number two, is remember, is seek for opportunities to serve rather than for opportunities to be served. Go to James. Watch this now. James chapter 3, and I want you to look at verse 14 through 16. Put it in your margin. Amen. We have to learn. God, teach us. Teach us, Lord, how to be who we need to be for you. Teach us about unity in the community according to the instruction that you've given us in your word. Notice what he says in James chapter 3, verse 14. It says, but if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not be arrogant and so lie against the truth. What he's saying here, he says, look, if you got bitterness in your heart, if you got jealousy in your heart, if you got selfish ambition in your heart, if you're arrogant and you're so arrogant to lie that is not about that. In other words, you're telling people, I'm not arrogant. What do you mean you're not arrogant? I'm not prideful. Okay. Watch this now. Notice what it says in verse 15. It says, this wisdom is not that which comes down from above, but is earthly, natural, demonic. Underscore that. He's saying, look, if you're trying to make it all about you, he's saying that could be a derivative of it being earthly, it could be natural, and it could also be demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder and every evil thing. Are y'all seeing that? He's saying, man, wherever you got jealousy, strife, if this exists in the church, God says, excuse me, I can't be a part of this. And when God steps away, people, from that which he created, it becomes Toys R Us. It becomes a circus. It becomes something that God did not create in the scriptures. And when we go to the scriptures and we look at it, we can look at what's going on. We can say, wait a minute, that don't look like what the church that Jesus built. When we see people walking by each other, rolling their eyes in the same place, he said, wait a minute, I don't see that in the scriptures anywhere. When you see people who need help and you got the means to help them and you've been praying to God, God, I want to help somebody, and they walk up to you and they express the exact need that you have in your pocket or at your house, and you walk away as if you never heard them. I'm trying to help us out today. The church looks like something, or it should, right? He says, man, vain glory, conceited. Now watch this, because I want to spend a great amount of my time on this last point. Number one, we said that the people in Christian community, they shine bright in displaying the true unity of the Spirit. Thank God for that. We shine bright, man. Wherever you go, you just let the Holy Ghost shine in and through you. You don't have to turn on the light. No, it should always be on, right? The second thing we said, you need to seek for opportunities to serve rather than for opportunities to be served. Stop making it all about you and get in a place where you can begin to serve others just as Jesus did. One of the things Jesus did before he ascended to the cross, before he ascended to heaven, he went to the cross. But even before that, he got his disciples together and he says, I'm going to teach you the ultimate serving. And he got down and he took a basin, filled it with water, and he took his rag and he began to wash his disciples' feet. Now, what does that look like today? Amen. What does that look like today? That means doing the dirty, grimy stuff that nobody else would want to be caught doing. What is that in your life? What has God called you to do? Who has he called you to go put your arms around and encourage in spite of what they may have said or did to you? We're talking about the love of Christ today. Now watch this now. The third thing, I'm going to spend some time here because I want you to get this. The third thing as it relates to people in the Christian community is they show forth humility that points directly to Jesus. They show forth humility that points directly to Jesus. Somebody's asking the question, what is humility? Let me help you out with that. Humility, watch this now, is the ability to cheerfully put away your own agenda for God's agenda, even if you don't get the credit for it. Okay? It's the ability to cheerfully, notice I said cheerfully now, somebody say cheerfully. Cheerfully put away your own agenda in place of God's agenda, even if you do not get the credit for it. It is demonstrated by submission. Now, the one thing that sets apart spiritual men and women, Christians, or the Christian community, is that we have learned to think as Christ thinks because we have the mind of Christ. A spiritual person examines life from God's perspective. All right? You want to know how you're doing in life? You need to gauge it from God's perspective. All right. Not what people are saying, not what other people are doing, because you can be following somebody and they doing the wrong thing. All right. When we were growing up, man, we wanted to be like older people in our family, in our generation. But what we found out when we got older, man, if we kept following them, we would have been in some serious trouble. Okay? We would have been in some serious trouble. So we needed a new blueprint, and that's why Jesus Christ came to show us how to live victoriously in this dark, sin-filled world. Okay? That's the beauty of Jesus, people. He came to show us how to live victoriously. Now, how many of you really want to live victoriously? Amen. How many of you want to live like what you believe? Amen. You believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. You believe that he is the God man. How many of you really want to live in a fashion where you know without the shadow of a doubt that I have victory? Well, you can do that starting today. If you have Jesus, if you receive him as Lord, remember, you fight not for victory, but you fight from a place of victory. You already got the victory. All right. If you already got the victory, how do people act when they got the victory? All right. They celebrate. Right. They're joyful because they recognize that whatever comes my way, come hell or high water, I have victory in Jesus by way of what he did on the cross over 2000 years ago. If I got some joyful people in this place today, are you joyful about what Jesus has done in your life? And this is the Apostle Paul in prison telling about the goodness of God. Man, he's in prison. Now, prison, I'm not talking about Mobile County prison. These prisons were prisons, all right? The stench, the smell, the darkness, everything was encompassed in that. But he conjured up enough ink on the paper, if you will, to write this letter to the church that he loved. Now, watch this now, because you need to get this last point as we kind of bring it in for a landing, because we need to show forth authentic humility that points directly to Jesus. Notice in verse 5 what he says here. He says, have this attitude or have this mind in yourself, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men, being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Man, Jesus was the ultimate sacrifice. You'll find no better example of sacrifice other than Jesus. These last points I'm going to give you as we bring this in for a landing, because I want you to know the ultimate model of sacrifice. The ultimate model of sacrifice. Notice this now. The first thing I want you to know about the ultimate model of sacrifice is that Jesus, he pressed the pause button on his divine form. He pressed the pause button on his divine form. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Notice the scripture says, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped. What does that mean? That simply means that he let go of his privileges and glory in heaven in order that we on earth might be saved. He pressed the pause button on his divinity. Now notice, Jesus, the only one of this kind, that's why we say in John 3:16, he is the begotten of God. He's uniquely made, the only one of his kind. He is 100% God and 100% man. But what Jesus did when he came into the earth is he pressed the pause button on his divinity so that he could humble himself and come in the form of a man. Notice that he didn't take the actions that he could have taken had he operated in his true, authentic divinity, right? He could have, while he was being crucified on the cross, find yourself in this. He could have called for a legion of angels to come and deal with everything and wipe it all out. But he became a man and he humbled himself so that he could pay the ultimate price for us so that we could live through him. Somebody say he paused. He put his divinity on pause for a minute so that he could fulfill the ultimate privileges of what he came to do. The second thing is he emptied himself of any rights. He emptied himself of any rights. Notice in verse 7 it says, but emptied himself, taking the form of a bondservant, and being made in the likeness of men. Somebody say likeness of men. So watch this now. He accepted suffering. He accepted misunderstanding. He accepted ill treatment. He accepted hatred. He accepted death on the cross. Okay? He accepted those things because he recognized that he came for the sole purpose of taking back what the enemy had stolen. See, the enemy came in and he caused chaos, disunity, and confusion. And Jesus said, I'm going down to correct all of that. And I recognize that I need to give my life in order for that to happen. And that's what he's did. That's what he's done for me and for you. He's given us his life, people. He's given us everything. So he came to create unity in community. So not only did he press the pause button on his divine form, not only did he empty himself of any rights, but notice he became a man. He became a man. When the angel appeared to Mary, she said, you shall call his name Jesus because he will save the people from their sins. Amen. His name means savior. In the Hebrew, his name is Joshua, one who saves. He's the Messiah, the Christ, the Christos, the only one who was reserved to take away the sins of the world. Amen. Had it not been for Jesus, y'all, do y'all know we would be bound and on our way to hell? But Jesus stepped in and he interrupted the plan. He said, pardon this interruption. Enemy, I know it looks like you got the victory right now, but I'm coming down and I'm going to interrupt what you're doing so that people will know that regardless of the hell or high water that they go through, they will have victory in me. I thank God for Jesus today. And we have victory in Jesus. So he emptied himself. In other words, he set himself aside. I love how the Hebrew writer says, go to Hebrews, watch this now. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, because y'all know this scripture, but it's powerful. And when we begin to think about what Jesus has done for us, you mean to tell me that you stepped out of heaven to come to earth so that I could have life and I could have life more abundantly? Watch this now. In Hebrews chapter 12, chapter 4, beginning in verse 15, it says, for we do not have, watch this, a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in all things as we are, yet without sin. Now, I got to finish this because you need to, anytime you're reading this book of Hebrews, you need to make sure you read verse 16 because there's a therefore there. He says, therefore, let us draw near with confidence to the throne of grace so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Have you ever been in a time of need? Some of y'all may have needed one thing or some of you may have needed another, but guess what? The source is the same. Jesus is the source where you're going to find everything that you need to go on, but you got to go boldly to the throne of grace. Somebody say boldly. You got to come boldly. That means confidently to his throne of grace to obtain mercy, one version says, and find grace to time to help in your time of need. He's awesome in all his ways, people. He's awesome in all his ways. Not only that, but watch this now. Not only does he press the pause button on divinity, not only does he empty himself of any rights, but he became a man and he became a servant. Not only did he become a man, but he became one who served. We talked about that in Mark's Gospel 10:45. He didn't come to be served, but he came to serve. Here's my favorite, the last two. He says he was obedient unto death. He was obedient unto death. He was on death row and he could have stopped everything. Remember in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was sweating drops of sweat like blood, and he asked the Father, he said, if there's any way this cup of suffering can be removed from me, please remove it. Have you ever asked God to remove something from you that just seemed a little too hard? God, this is just too hard. I can't handle this, Lord. You got to take this away from me. Well, when you feel that way, and some of you may even feel that way right now, remember that Jesus, he endured the same shame and suffering, and he went through everything that you're going through or everything that you will go through. He is the God-man who has gone ahead of you. And you can go through, watch this, if you're a believer of Jesus Christ, if you have the Holy Spirit of God living inside of you, you can go through anything. And I'm talking to people right now. You've gone through something that you didn't think you could go through, but it was the grace and the love and the power of God that got you up out of that bed, that got you out of that depressed state, that picked you up out and got you on your two feet and told you to put your hands to the plow and keep moving forward in the things of God, because there's more behind this. I'm talking to people, maybe you lost a loved one and you thought it was over, but you found out that it was just beginning, because God's grace is sufficient for thee. Do I got a witness in this place today? Maybe somebody in this place today, maybe you were down to nothing and you finally got to the point of life where you realize that anytime I'm feeling down to nothing, I'm recognizing that my God is up to something. God, you're going to make my path straight according to your glories and riches in Christ Jesus, Lord God. You make my path straight. I'm talking to somebody today, and maybe you'll go through something even after this service today. But what I'm here to tell you right now is you got one who emptied himself. He poured himself out so that we could have victory and walk in victory. You got to start walking, people of God. I'm talking to the community now. You got to start walking like you've been delivered. You got to start walking with your head up like God has done something in your life. Amen. You might got some things going on, but you mean to tell me that that is more powerful than the God that died for you on the cross and then got up with all power in his hand? There's nothing more powerful than our God. He is God forever, and he will be God forever. And he died a terrible death for us. He who knew no sin, our sin. He who knew no sin, Jesus, became sin so that we in him might become the righteousness of God. Man, that's powerful, people, that he wants us to be the righteousness of God, but there's only one way you can get to that righteousness of God, and that is through Jesus Christ. The last thing Paul, he says, I need to let you know, Philippians, I know that you're going through. I know that you're experiencing some challenges, but in verse 9, I need to remind you and let you know something. I need to let you know about the one who has the name above every name. I need to let you know about when you're going through, you need to be reminded of the one to call on. He says, for this reason in verse 9, also God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. So that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow. Paul, where did you get that from? You put it in your margin, Isaiah 45:23. It was already stated in the Old Testament. He said, I'm going to let you know that every knee will bow of those things who are in heaven, of those things on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord, the glory of God the Father. Oh, when you talk about the glory of God the Father, what does glory mean? Glory means to make God's name great. Glory means to put God on display. When God wanted to display to his world the love that he had for the world, regardless of where you've been and what you've done, he sent Jesus. Jesus is the billboard to the world to let them know that Jesus is the way to heaven, that Jesus is the way to overcome any opposition that you may be facing in life right now, that Jesus is the one that will give you peace even with your enemies and those who despitefully use you. He is the way, he is the truth, he is the life, he is the second Adam, the one who was sent to replace the first Adam to show us how to do it right. He is the one above all. He is the one that all in all. He is the mighty God. He is our advocate. If you need a lawyer, he's the one standing on your side, letting you know and letting the enemy know that what you meant for bad, I'm going to turn it around and use it for good. The devil is the accuser of the brethren, but Jesus has come in as an advocator, and he's come in to say that this case has been closed over 2,000 years ago. I don't know if you read the book or you know the story, but I got up out of the grave and I took the keys even, and I'm using them now to loose people free. Is there a witness in this place today? He's our advocate, people of God. Not only is he our advocate, but he's almighty. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He's the one who is able to do exceedingly and abundantly more than we could ever ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. He is the one who was in the beginning that said, let us create man in our image and in our likeness. He is the imago Dei of God. People of God, you're made in the image of God. And now that you're made in the image of God, you better recognize that you are the image of God. When God created you, he threw away the mold. He says, I don't need to make nobody else like them. I'm going to pour my spirit in them. And when people see them, they will see me. Oh, hallelujah in this place today. Is there unity in this place today? Oh, you can't make it about you, people. He's the great potentate. He's the bread of life. He says, I am the manna that Moses was talking about that came down from heaven. You're looking for the natural manna, but I am the manna. I am the captain of salvation. I am the chief shepherd, the one who coming to take away the sins of the world. Not only is he the chief shepherd, but he's the good shepherd. Oh, David was talking about him way over there in Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. You better testify if you know this today. I shall not want. Lord, I ain't got want for anything. You're the creator of heavens and earth. You spoke the earth in existence. Whatever you need, God, I got. You got it for me, Lord God. Whatever you need, he's got it right now in the name of Jesus. Oh, he's awesome in all his ways, people. I'm here. You got to try him. He's the great cornerstone. He's the creator. Oh, he's the door, as we talked about a few weeks ago, that's been opened so that we can have access for him. He's the everlasting father. He's the forerunner. He is God. Remember what old Thomas said? He says, I'm not going to believe until I can put my hands into his nail print. And then he showed him his, he said, go ahead and put him in there. And he put him in there. And Thomas said, my Lord, my God. He understood that Jesus is God because there's only one. He said, what's the greatest commandment? To love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And the second is likened unto it, to love your neighbor as yourself. I'm telling you, people of God, Jesus is the great I am. He is the I am of I ams. When Moses said, who do I say sent me? He said, tell him I am sent me. Jesus got in a debate with some religious folk. And when you get in a debate with some religious folk, all you need to say is what he said. He said, man, how are you able to do that? You're not even 50 years old. We're talking about you were before Abraham. He said, what are you talking about? You knew Abraham. And Jesus looked at them and he said, before Abraham was, I am. What you need to know today, people of God, before Abraham, before Moses, before Joseph, before any of these great men and women of God, Jesus has already always existed. And he's still at your side right now. He made himself of no reputation and took upon the form of a servant and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. That's who I want to follow. I don't know about you, but I want to follow Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, the God-man, the one who cometh to take away the sins of the world. Listen, you're here today. I'm talking about unity in the community. I don't know what y'all are talking about. But unity comes through love. Unity comes through authenticity. Amen. I can tell you how much I love you, but no, I need you to start showing me. I want to start showing you how much I love you. I want to go the distance with you. I'm going to pick you up when you fall down. When you ask me to pray for you, I'm going to say, all right, stop what you're doing right now. I'm going to pray for you right now in the name of Jesus. I'm talking about unity in the community. I'm not embarrassed what people say. I'm going into the restaurant. I'm not ducking and dodging, trying. I know I want you people to see that I'm praying over this food that the restaurant owners got from the ground, which came from our God, who's able to make things grow for his glory. We're talking about the Almighty God. He's our advocate, people. He makes a way out of no way. He does things well. He's the Lamb of God who has come to take away the sins of the world. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the mighty God. He's the great mediator between God and man. God says, I need somebody to advocate and mediate. Jesus said, give me a body, I'll go. Hallelujah in this place today. And as we pause for this minute, as you're standing to your feet, we owe all to him. You owe whether you know it or not, everything you are is because of Jesus. Lord, why didn't that happen when I tried to even do that to myself? He said, because I have you in the palm of my hand. See, many are the afflictions of the righteous, even the righteous. Here's the conclusion of that verse. But God. Somebody say, but God. Oh, somebody got a situation and you need to not put a period there. You need to put a comma. That means that there's something else after what's happening. Oh, I lost a loved one, but God. Oh, I ain't got no money in the but God. I just can't seem to get along, but God. I don't like how these people are treated, but God. But God. But God. Father, we thank you today. We thank you for the but God. We thank you, Lord, that you're able to make all things new. And all you ask of us is to surrender and to give our lives to you, Lord God. Lord, we're not ashamed of you. You said if you're ashamed of me when I return, I'll be ashamed of you. So, Lord, we're not ashamed. We recognize that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's nobody here under the sound of my voice who has never sinned. If they say that, Lord God, they are of the devil, because you say that all have sinned and have fallen short of your glory. But you made a way out of no way. And we thank you for it today, Lord, that Jesus is that way. So as we all stand to our feet in Jesus' name, listen, we're never here to embarrass you or put a mic before you. But I want you to know the God that Paul was writing to the Philippians about. He was the God of that rich woman, Lydia. He was the God of that formerly possessed girl. He was the God of Paul and Silas that got them out of the jail. And he became the God of the jailer who locked them up. Today, people of God, don't leave here. Don't leave here today without receiving Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. Somebody says, what do I need to do that? Well, the Bible says if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. We thank you today, Lord God, for your promise. We thank you for your promise today. Listen, you're here today. We're never here to embarrass you, put a mic before you. But I want you, if you're serious about the unity that you desire in your own life, to begin unity in your family, in your community, in your job, in your generation. It only comes by way of Jesus. And you're in this place today. And you recognize that, God, I've fallen short. If I were to stand before you today, I don't have a reason for you to let me into your heaven. But after today, Lord God, I want to confess today, I want to confess Jesus as Lord and Savior of my life. And I can leave here without the shadow of a doubt that regardless of what happens, even after this service, that I will spend an eternity with you. Listen, if you're here today, you're here for salvation. I just want you to lift your hands, lift it high so that I can see it. I'm here today. I'm here to give my life to Jesus. Praise God. You can put your hand down after you raise it. God bless you today. God bless you. What I want you to know, people of God, every head bowed, every eye closed, you can always start again with God. God is married to the backslider. He's the God of another chance. I stopped saying second chances a long time ago because I blew that a long time ago. But he is the God of another chance and another chance and another chance. But I'm telling you, when you get right with God, the stuff that you used to do, you don't want to do anymore. Because he has captured your heart. He has taken out the heart of stone and given you a heart of flesh, where now you begin to live in and through him. Today, you're here and you want to restore, you want God to restore your life. You want him to give you a fresh start, a new opportunity, a fresh start. He will do it, but you have to acknowledge that you need it. Amen. He will give it to you, but you have to ask. He will give it to you, but you have to acknowledge. You have to confess. Lord, I'm saying the same thing you say about my situation. I need you today. If you're here today, just raise your hand, every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, I need you today. I'm following after you and I'm chasing after you today. God bless you. You can put your hand down. God bless you. My last appeal, every head bowed, every eye closed. I'm looking for a church home, a place where I can get plugged in to a place that shows the unity of Christ, a place that's aspiring to do things for God's glory, not to make it all about them, but to make it all about Jesus. If you're here today, you're welcome in this place. God is speaking to your heart, and we receive you with open arms for any one of those appeals. But this appeal is, I'm looking for a church home, and I believe God has sent me here for such a time as this. You can raise your hand. Let me see your hand. Put your hand up. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Praise God. Come on, people. Let's give God a praise in this place. Come on. Come on. Hallelujah. Listen. Listen, if you raise your hand for any one of those appeals, we want to pray with you. We want to connect with you. We want to let you know about the love of God. If you're here for salvation, you're here for rededication.
Thank you for joining us today here on the New Generation Church Podcast. If you have any questions regarding your faith in Jesus Christ, please visit our website at www.newgc.org/following-Jesus. Be sure to watch on YouTube or subscribe to listen on iTunes, Google Podcasts, or Spotify. For additional information on New Generation Church, please visit our website at www.newgc.org. If you would like to give to this ministry, please text the word GIVE to 251-278-2225. Again, that number is 251-278-2225. Or you can mail your GIVE to 1350 Cody Road North, Mobile, Alabama 36608. Again, thank you for listening. May the Lord bless you real good, is our prayer.